From the Cronkite studios in downtown Phoenix, this is Cronkite News.
The group Don't Punish Pain rallies at the Capitol for patients with chronic pain to have easier access to opioids. See how the fight between battling addiction and comforting those truly in need played out.
Plus, activists pushing to make Tucson, Arizona's first sanctuary city. The idea receiving swift pushback before it's even reached the ballot.
And the cost of electric scooters on the rise in Tempe, how the city is trying to control the scooter invasion and what it means for riders.
Cronkite News starts now.
Good evening and welcome to Cronkite News on Arizona PBS. I'm Bion Wang.
And I'm Haley Brandt. Thank you for joining us. A movement created by one woman in Rhode Island is now a nationwide effort. It's called Don't Punish Pain. Cronkite News reporter Jennifer Alvarez went to the Arizona State Capitol this morning to find out why people are rallying.
Don't Punish Pain is a nationwide effort that supports opioids for pain treatment and demands that chronically ill patients or people with severe pain aren't left out. Some people this morning saying they even felt discriminated against for not being granted the same access to opioids that they used to have. One story after another, after another.
If I could give them one minute or even 1 hour of the pain that I lived through, I think that they could maybe understand a little bit more.
Each one, a story about physical pain and a plea for justice in the fight for opioid prescriptions. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention say opioid pain medications have serious risks. And according to the Arizona Department of Health Services, from June 2017 to now, there have been over 16,000 suspected overdoses from opioids in our state. In 2016, the CDC created guidelines for opioid prescriptions. And last May, Governor Doug Ducey pushed through legislation to more regulate prescriptions. And the people here claim that these guidelines have negatively impacted their access to the treatment that they need.
If I didn't feel like my quality of life and that of my friends and the man that I love and live with were in literal danger, I wouldn't be here.
They say even doctors have been affected.
The doctors are scared. I really, truly believe that they're scared.
And they want action.
I want Arizona state law to take away the arbitrary delineation demanding that chronic pain patients with established records and no missed pill counts or anything choose between medical marijuana or narcotics.
Protests were held at major cities across the U.S., and ultimately, these people just hope that someone will listen and make a change. Live in the broadcast center, Jennifer Alvarez, Cronkite News.
A new proposal could loosen Arizona's medical marijuana laws. Senator Sonny Borelli from District 5 is pushing to extend the state's certification for medical marijuana cards from 1 year to two. After the first 2 years, certifications would go back to lasting 1 year, but with the renewal fees cut from $150 to $50. Borelli has also proposed Senate Bill 1137 that would give the Arizona Department of Agriculture $2 million to begin testing marijuana sold at state dispensaries.
Another proposed bill could change Arizona's voting rules after last year's delayed election results. Arizona State Senator Michelle Ugenti-Rita from District 23 introduced the bill, which would still allow mail-in ballots, but only if they were sent in through the mail. Ugenti-Rita says the purpose of the bill is to cut down on the backlog that has caused delays in previous elections, like the 2018 midterm. Arizona ballots were not completely counted for nearly 2 weeks after Election Day.
The Arizona State Legislature has been in session for less than a month, and already we have a question about one lawmaker's ethics. Yesterday, Democratic Representative Reginald Boulding moved to expel Republican Representative David Stringer from the Arizona House. The move came after new documents revealed Stringer was accused of sex crimes in the 1980s. Cronkite News reporter Bryce Newberry talked to Boulding today and has a story.
And I motion to expel Representative David Stringer, and I request a roll call vote.
A bold move from State Representative Reginald Boulding, calling for the expulsion of Republican Representative David Stringer.
With Representative Stringer here, this cloud continues to hang over this body, and it makes it very difficult for us to move forward.
Boulding's motion comes after Governor Doug Ducey and other Democrats also called for Stringer to step down. But there's no code of conduct for state legislators, even after several scandals in recent sessions.
Unfortunately, Arizona has become the brunt of many late night jokes because of some of the alleged improprieties that have taken place at the Arizona Capitol. It's really important that our state leaders are making sure that there is clear guidelines for behavior for elected officials and that those are being enforced in an equitable manner.
Last session, legislative leaders called for the creation of a code of conduct after Representative Don Shooter was accused of sexual harassment. But that's up to new legislative leaders.
I don't think it's all that complicated, and I don't think we have to reinvent the wheel. I think there are standards out there that we can apply and then adapt to. And I don't think it's that difficult, but we just need the energies to do it.
Those leaders, including Senate President Karen Fan and House Speaker Rusty Bowers, did not respond to requests for an interview. So until there's a code of conduct, or until Stringer steps down, Boulding says he'll keep the pressure on.
What we do know is that it's important to make sure that people are held accountable and those who elected us know that they have people who are fighting for them.
The House voted to recess on Monday before voting on Stringer's expulsion. For now, the House Ethics Committee will investigate complaints against Stringer. In Phoenix, Bryce Newberry, Cronkite News.
Organizers in Tucson are working to collect signatures for a proposed ordinance allowing them to become Arizona's first sanctuary city. But the ordinance is already facing controversy. Cronkite News reporter John Cardinelli is joining us live with more on the heated debate. John?
The Southern Presbyterian Church in Tucson is known as the birthplace of the sanctuary city movement back in the 1980s. But now, decades later, Tucson is trying to become Arizona's first sanctuary city if one local organization gets its way.
When you really analyze what SB 1070 meant to all of Arizona, you start realizing that this is just the very first step into building an Arizona where we're all thriving.
Zyra Livier is the woman behind the People's Defense Initiative, pushing, they say, to make Tucson a more inclusive and welcoming city for everyone. ACLU attorney Billy Peard helped draft the proposed ordinance. No easy feat considering Arizona laws like SB 1070.
So one example that, to my knowledge, has never been appeared anywhere else in other city ordinances is a provision that would prohibit local police officers from conducting certain types of law enforcement activities so that it essentially limits the degree to which local police and Border Patrol can collaborate.
The proposed ordinance is already raising eyebrows with some local lawmakers, like Arizona House Representative John Kavanaugh, putting its legality in doubt.
Arizona law requires police officers, if they have reasonable suspicion to believe that a person's in the country illegal, and it's practical to do so, to detain that person, question them, and if they believe the person is here illegally, to call ICE. So the Tucson ordinance would be mandating that police officers break state law.
Phoenix attorney Josh Nunez says what still remains from SB 1070 will make it difficult for the initiative, if passed, to be implemented.
If the officer who's investigating some other crime and comes to believe, given the totality of the circumstances, that the individual is here unlawfully, then at that point he would be allowed to ascertain the legal status and would be allowed to contact ICE. And so the question is, does this initiative preclude that? And I don't think it does.
Peard says despite the potential challenges, there are no plans right now to revise the initiative.
Well, the language that you have in your hand is the language that will be put before the voters in November if we obtain enough signatures to qualify for the ballot.
If the people of Tucson vote in favor of the initiative, then I think it might stand a challenge, a constitutional challenge. And that is because there is enough ambiguity in the way it's written to allow for a lot of interpretation and allow it to stand. If anything, this is going to end up in litigation, obviously. There's going to be a lawsuit, and we'll see what the courts decide.
Currently, the People's Defense Initiative has around 2,000 signatures. They will need roughly 9,000 signatures by June in order to put it to voters on the November ballot. In downtown Phoenix, John Cardinelli, Cronkite News.
Dockless scooters and bikes sit on almost every corner in Tempe. And up until recently, there were no regulations for them.
Now the city is trying to control these vehicles by licensing companies like Bird, Lime, and Razor. Earlier this month, Tempe City Council approved a licensing system which will require shared transportation companies to comply with a list of rules. Tempe City Council met with company stakeholders to come up with a plan, which includes putting scooters in certain areas, sharing data about ride usage, and paying several fees.
The money that companies give the city will not be for profit. It will be used to run the new program which Tempe created to keep people safe.
We want them to be respectful of our residents, especially on the sidewalk, because a lot of times the scooters are left blocking the sidewalk, which would affect the ADA residents in our community and just in general walking around.
So far, none of the companies running in Tempe have received a license. They have 30 days to get one. Otherwise, they won't be welcome on Tempe streets.
So we want to hear from you now. How do you feel about electric scooters? Are they dangerous, annoying, fun, or convenient?
Just go to our Cronkite News Twitter feed to vote in our live interactive poll and join the conversation.
Coming up next on Cronkite News, a new bill targeting discrimination.
How legislatures are hoping to protect employees from being fired for their sexual orientation or gender identity.
And how could the new movement in Washington to try to make impeachment easier impact Arizona? The answer after the break.
With wildfires, a scarcity of water, and other environmental issues facing the Earth today, it's critical to stay up to date with local impacts of a changing climate. That's why we created Elemental, covering sustainability, a multimedia collaboration between public television and radio stations. From climate change to water conservation to renewable energy and much more, Elemental covers the latest in sustainability news. Find our stories on our website, elementalreports.com.
As journalists at Cronkite News, we report on stories that matter to you by focusing on the local impact. We dig deeper and work tirelessly to keep you informed.
Live in Wickerburg.
Live in Los Angeles.
In Cleveland.
In Washington.
In Louisville.
From Jerusalem.
Live in Philadelphia.
From around the world to right here in Phoenix.
At Cronkite News, we report the facts and stick to the truth.
Former Arizona Senator Jeff Flake has officially taken a new job as a CBS contributor. The announcement came today on CBS This Morning as Flake says he will be working on a new series for the network called Common Ground. The series will shine a light on opposing groups coming together and working across the aisle.
Well, Common Ground might be dead in Washington, but it's alive and well everywhere else, on city councils, in state legislatures. Any kind of association or group, people find common ground. It just often doesn't translate into something in Washington.
Flake also confirmed he will not challenge President Trump in a Republican primary in the 2020 presidential election. He said he hopes there's a Republican challenger, but it will not be him. The former Arizona politician was openly critical of the president while serving in the Senate.
Arizona is one of many states where an employee can be fired for their sexual orientation or gender identity. But two bills have been introduced that could change that. Reporter Ariel Sock was at the state capitol today and has the details on these bills.
The purpose of Senate Bill 1249 and House Bill 2546 is to include sexual orientation and gender identity to already existing non-discrimination bills. The current legislation protects employees from being terminated for various reasons, including their race, age, and religion. Democratic Representative Daniel Hernandez held a press conference today to announce non-discrimination legislation. He was joined by business leaders, religious figures, as well as Republican Senator Kate Brophy McGee. Her message is that this bill will reach across the aisle.
The bill has been introduced in prior years. Last year, I was the only Republican to sign on. This year, we have another Republican who has signed on. And conversations with my colleagues behind the scenes tell me there may be more Republican votes.
Not everyone is on board with these bills passing. The Center for Arizona Policy sent out a statement that reads in part, These bills undermine constitutional guaranteed freedoms of speech and religion, threaten women's equality and privacy, and harm small businesses. In the Broadcast Center, Arielle Salk, Cronkite News.
Acting U.S. Attorney General Matthew Whitaker said yesterday that the investigation of possible Russian meddling in the 2016 presidential election may be wrapping up soon. But President Donald Trump's critics, including several from Arizona, don't seem willing to wait. They took their case for impeachment to Capitol Hill, as Micah Bledsoe reports from our Washington Bureau.
Hundreds of activists walked to Capitol Hill with Tom Steyer after his press conference for the Need to Impeach Summit, demanding the impeachment of President Donald Trump. They're walking to hand deliver to different members of Congress articles of impeachment. Among them are a handful of residents from Arizona.
One voice, one sound.
Tiffany Jones Bowling says she traveled to D.C. from Avondale to speak for others who couldn't make the trip.
Every day, this president, this lawless president, is doing something else to harm the United States of America. Right now is the time to act. We cannot afford to wait. We have to act today.
The rally comes as the investigation of Russian meddling in the 2016 election is reportedly nearing an end. But these advocates, like Phoenix resident Redeem Robinson, say they aren't willing to wait.
So as someone that's from Arizona, I believe the one abusing pardons, especially since he pardoned Joe Arpaio, who was convicted.
Need to Impeach founder Tom Steyer says there is more than enough evidence to call for Trump's impeachment.
There is a great cost to keeping this president in office, and Congress has a constitutional duty of oversight and one remedy within the Constitution for a corrupt president.
That's why Jones Bowling is here to keep the pressure on Congress.
We've written the letters, we've made the phone calls, and we've done everything that we could from afar. Now it's time to show up.
Though Steyer is optimistic of the victory with a Democratic House majority, the decision of impeachment is up to the Senate, which is ruled by Republicans. In Washington, Micah Bledsoe, Cronkite News.
While the House is in Democratic hands, House leaders have been hesitant to rush toward talks of impeachment, focusing instead on investigations of other Trump activities. The Republican National Committee, meanwhile, has called Steyer's organization, founded in 2017 and funded by the wealthy Steyer, his unhealthy obsession.
An ASU student paralyzed while playing baseball.
Up next, how a local derby is stepping up to help the former Sun Devil make a difference in other people's lives.
And we're on track to see record-breaking low temperatures across the nation tomorrow. How your Valley forecast compares coming up.
With wildfires, a scarcity of water, and other environmental issues facing the Earth today, it's critical to stay up to date with local impacts of a changing climate. That's why we created Elemental, covering sustainability, a multimedia collaboration between public television and radio stations. From climate change to water conservation to renewable energy and much more, Elemental covers the latest in sustainability news. Find our stories on our website, elementalreports.com.
As journalists at Cronkite News, we report on stories that matter to you by focusing on the local impact. We dig deeper and work tirelessly to keep you informed.
Live in Wickenburg.
Live in Los Angeles.
In Cleveland.
In Washington.
In Louisville.
From Jerusalem.
Live in Philadelphia.
From around the world to right here in Phoenix.
At Cronkite News, we report the facts and stick to the truth.
We'll be right back.
Israeli scientists believe they will have the cure for cancer in just a year. They claim the cure will be effective from the start, only last a couple weeks, have little to no side effects, and cost much less than other current treatments. This treatment will be personalized with a specific cocktail of drugs geared towards the type of cancer a patient has.
Former Sun Devil baseball player Corey Hahn's life changed forever when a 2011 accident during a baseball game paralyzed him from the waist down. As Cronkite News reporter Michaela Perkins explains, Corey was determined not to let his diagnosis dictate his life.
After Corey Hahn's recovery from his spinal cord injury, the Sun Devil baseball alum knew he wanted to make a difference for others in his situation.
You know, I may not be playing the game, but I'm doing the next best thing, and I'm still in it, and that's an amazing feeling for me.
The National Spinal Cord Injury Statistical Center estimates that in the first year alone, a person who suffers a spinal cord injury will need to spend anywhere between $350,000 and $1.1 million on healthcare and living expenses. It's that massive cost that led Hahn and his friend, Pittsburgh Pirates pitcher and fellow Sun Devil alum Trevor Williams, to start Project 34.
A part of our goal is to not only supply, you know, resources, whether it's via medical supplies or rehab, but also be that vehicle to spread awareness and continue to let the community grow and show, you know, how amazing these people are.
Over the weekend, Dingers in the Desert, the inaugural fundraiser event for Project 34, featured a home run derby competition. Little leaguers, collegiate players, and even current MLB players all came out to support the cause.
You know, when Trevor asked me to do it and Corey asked me to do it, I just couldn't resist. So, you know, being a part of it meant a lot to me just because, you know, Corey means a lot to this program and this program means a lot to me. So, you know, I wouldn't have it any other way.
For them to help and support and, you know, have us out here, it's great on them. You know, we're two former alumni and, you know, the Sun Devil Brotherhood is, you know, is thick.
For Corey and Trevor, this is just the beginning for Project 34. With the support of the Arizona Diamondbacks, Pittsburgh Pirates, and Sun Devil Baseball, the two plan to make an impact for the spinal cord injury community that reaches far beyond the diamond.
You know, the one unique thing about Project 34 is the name itself, is it's Project 34 for a reason, is that this is always a project. This is always going to be something that we don't have an end goal. We want to keep pushing as far as we can. I think the one thing we look at is being able to impact as many lives as we can. If that means we were able to reach out to the entire community, then we will.
Both Hahn and Williams have high expectations for their organization, hoping to help as many of the nearly 300,000 people living in the U.S. with spinal cord injuries. In Tempe, Michaela Perkins, Cronkite News.
Project 34 said Dingers in the Desert raised $10,000 for the spinal cord injury community.
If you're planning to travel to or from Arizona, you might want to check your flight status. Due to the severe snow weather around the country, flights have been canceled and delayed. Today alone, 24 flights were canceled and 22 have been delayed at Sky Harbor International Airport. These conditions are expected to last at least through the rest of the week. And don't forget to check those flight statuses and keep an eye on those temperatures.
And speaking of those temperatures, here in Arizona, we are warming up this week.
That's right. Recently, I've only had to wear a light sweater. But Lauren, how does our state compare to the rest of the country right now?
Well, a light sweater is going to be nothing compared to what the people out east are going to have to wear if they're even thinking about going outside. Today through Thursday, they're going to be hit with bitterly cold temperatures, even life-threatening in some cities. Chicago, for example, if you're thinking about going outside for even 10 minutes, you're under the threat for frostbite. And there's been hundreds of flight cancellations across the nation, and there's going to be more. So if you're planning to travel out east, you're going to want to keep an eye out on those as well. And to put this into perspective for you, with wind chill factoring in, Chicago tomorrow feeling like negative 42 while we're feeling closer to low 70. So over 100 degree gap in what they're going to be feeling versus what we're going to be feeling. So we're certainly not going to be complaining tomorrow, not through the rest of the week, not even through the weekend. For Super Bowl Sunday this weekend, looking forward to it. If you have last minute errands, you're running on Sunday, running around getting ready to host some Super Bowl event, you'll be clear of rain and beautiful temperatures in the mid 60s. Atlanta, though, with slight rain chances. But taking a look at our 7-day forecast, we're seeing slight rain chances for Thursday, just 30% in those late evening hours. But we couldn't ask for near perfect winter temperatures for the rest of the week. Slightly dipping, but still low 70s, high 60s. Can't complain. For Cronkite Weather, I'm Lauren Sheeler.
When we come back, save our schools, Arizona.
Educators across the state coming together to keep the Red for Ed movement alive.
As journalists at Cronkite News, we report on stories that matter to you by focusing on the local impact. We dig deeper and work tirelessly to keep you informed.
Live in Wickerburg.
Live in Los Angeles.
In Cleveland.
In Washington.
In Louisville.
From Jerusalem.
Live in Philadelphia.
From around the world to right here in Phoenix.
At Cronkite News, we report the facts and stick to the truth.
As sure as night is dark and day is light, I keep you on my mind both day and night.
The song came from my mother's fear. You know, you're going out on the road and these girls are coming up and to you, and he wrote, I walk the line. I'm gonna stay true to you.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine.
Red for Ed is still alive in the Valley. Yesterday, dozens of education advocates gathered at the Capitol once again to let legislators know they're ready for action. Education advocates who participated in last year's Red for Ed rallies gathered for the first Education Committee hearing of this legislative session as they wore the same shirts from last year's walkouts. Members of Save Our Schools Arizona handed out the shirts to support the cause, but that wasn't their only message to legislators.
To show that we are watching, there are some great ideas being proposed for public education this year, and we want to show our support for those. And there's also a couple bad ideas floating around, so we want to let them know that we are watching and we will come here if we need to fight those bad bills as well.
Members of Save Our Schools say there's more work to be done, and they'll continue to come back in red and make efforts to stop lawmakers if they have to.
That's it for Cronkite News tonight. Thanks for joining us.
For top Arizona stories anytime, go to cronkitenews.azpbs.org.